we think that there's more than a trace of ideology in everything he's doing, that the whole of his policy seems to be dictated by an anti-Russian obsession, not by a real NATO security.
And what sort of a response are you looking for from the Americans to Mr. Andropov's offer?
Well, I hope that they would seize it with both hands. Any offer is worth examining, discussing. George is better than war. That's what Churchill said. It still remains true today.
But is there any evidence that President Reagan and his administration are really interested in arms control?
Well, that, I think, is the most worrying thing of the lot. The people whom he's appointed really don't seem to me to be interested. Indeed, they've said that they're not interested. Edelman has said that he wasn't in the least interested in it and that it was all a sham.
Well, the president feels that obviously we want to give full consideration to this latest move by the Soviet Union. But what we need to do now is to go forward into the negotiations themselves, which resume on the 17th of May, and see whether this latest step means a real movement, which we hope it will be, towards a resolution of the intermediate-range nuclear weapon conflict and a means of reducing those weapons, hopefully eventually getting to our goal, which is removing an entire category of weapons from the face of the earth.
Now, last night, the House of Representatives voted for a freeze, with conditions, on the production and deployment of nuclear missiles. Now, do you go along with that? Is that not just telling the president, hurry up?
Well, I think what the what this whole episode, which culminated in last night's vote, indicates is a uniform objective that all of our people have, and we think most people in the world have, certainly the leaders of the world and the free world, and that is to have a reduction in nuclear weapons, a reduction in the potential for nuclear war. The objective, obviously, is to have peace without the threat of nuclear war. This has gone on now for several weeks. It reflects, I think, the confusion and the differences of opinion on how you attain that objective, because as you know, there's been much debate, hours and hours of debate, many amendments, and I think the resolution last night, which actually was a freeze, on a mutual freeze, a freeze on both sides of the Iron Curtain, but also with the idea that the negotiations for reduction in weapons should go forward, and that if that reduction in weapons and the negotiations were not successful, if the reduction was not forthcoming, then the freeze should be ended. I think that, as I say, this is not precisely in accord with the president's strategy, but it does reflect a similar objective, and I think that what it means is that a majority of the House agrees with what we're trying to do. They would like it hurried up, but frankly, having a freeze without the reduction certainly does not achieve the objective, which is to have less, not the same number of nuclear weapons.
Wouldn't you agree that it's highly unlikely to have any exchange, a nuclear exchange in Europe, without the British strategic missiles coming into such a war?
Well, first of all, the whole purpose of this is to prevent any exchange of missiles. And what we're talking about in this negotiation, the intermediate range negotiation, is a specific category of land-based missiles, the intermediate range missiles. The British missiles are not in that category. They're the weapon of last resort, as Francis Pym said.
But
also, they're sea-based. They're not even land-based.
But are you encouraging the British to take this stand?
Well, I think that everybody recognizes that that's the only stand that they can take. And we're in full agreement with the stand that the British government is taking. What we're trying to do, we have a specific category of weapon here. Actually, if you want to look at all weapons, there is a way in which we can reduce the strategic weapons, the Soviets as well, which has a preponderance of those weapons over anything that might be present in the United Kingdom or France or the other NATO allies. And that is the strategic arms reduction talks. But we're talking now here about a separate and specific category of weapons, the intermediate range weapons, of which the Soviets have a monopoly in Europe at the present time, and in which we say that the only real way to remove this whole category of weapons is to have a 0-0 base on both sides.
On those missiles, do you accept that there are serious fears in this country that the United States could launch missiles from British soil without the British government having to give its approval?
Well, I think on that subject there are consultations going on between our governments, and we're very satisfied, as we believe the United Kingdom government is, with the existing arrangements and with the consultations that are now going on about that subject.
You would expect Mrs. Thatcher to take that up with President Reagan when she sees him?
Oh, it may come up in the discussions, but as I say, I think the arrangements that we have between our countries are very satisfactory on both sides.
Do the peace movements worry you?
They don't worry me in terms, again, as we talked earlier, of their objectives. As a matter of fact, as the president has said, if he thought that what they're advocating would be effective, he would march with them. He said that last summer when he was in Europe. But the problem is, the objective is there, it's a matter of how you attain that objective. And to the extent that the peace movements give an idea to the Soviet Union that somehow they can get what they want without negotiating it out with us, that they can get it because of public opinion either in Europe or in the United States, in that sense it could do a disservice. But I think the main thing is, if the leaders of the peace movement understand that there is no man in the world more dedicated to peace, more dedicated to arms control than President Reagan, and that he is joined by the leaders of the other NATO countries, then I think that perhaps they could get behind a mutual reduction in weapons on both sides, and then a freeze at much lower levels of weaponry.
Now, in Central America, the president seems to have questioned the legitimacy of the government of Nicaragua. What does that mean? Does it mean anybody is now free to topple that government?
No, I think what he's talking about is to put that government in its historical sense. Here we have a government that has been in office, that declared itself into office through revolution. It has not had elections, as, for example, El Salvador has. It's very interesting to contrast the two countries. It has persecuted its people. It has had very autocratic and authoritarian rule. It has committed all kinds of offenses against the Mosquito Indians. It has allowed, encouraged, and participated in the importation of subversion to guerrillas and terrorists in the neighboring country of El Salvador. In other words, it has, both from an international standpoint and a national standpoint, acted as an outlaw. What the president has suggested is that there are people who are opposed to that government. He has also said that the United States' role in that area is only to prevent the flow of arms and assistance to the terrorists that are operating in El Salvador.
You see, sometimes people say that President Reagan exaggerates when he makes statements like that and he gets people worried. Do you not think there is some exaggeration about what the president has been saying about Central America?
No, I don't think there's any exaggeration, because I think it's important that we recognize what is happening there, and it's important that we recognize the importance of Central America to the United States and to that whole hemisphere. We have a situation there in which democratically elected governments like El Salvador are now in danger from terrorism that is imported from other countries, imported from Cuba, imported from the Soviet bloc, in which we have people from foreign countries acting as advisors and assisting those terrorists, warring against the people of El Salvador and their elected government. If you realize that from the standpoint of the United States, San Diego, Tucson, Dallas, several of our major cities are closer to El Salvador than they are to the capital, Washington, D.C., you can see why this is a subject of concern.
Another running sore on President Reagan's foreign policy, his plan for the West Bank and the continuing problems of Lebanon. Palestine journalist Ahmed Halidi.
America's own difficulties in the Middle East will really start to show, to emerge, once they get the Israelis out of Lebanon, if indeed they can get them out of Lebanon. The difficulties that the Americans have faced so far will be nothing compared with the difficulties they're going to face in getting the Israelis out of the West Bank.
The Israelis said, when it was first formulated, that this was a stillborn plan. Now, 8 months later, after the Arabs have also said that they will have nothing to do with it, it is not revived. I mean, it's still dead. It really has. I mean, it never had any chance. And if one can have less than nothing, I mean, it's even less so.
Well, I think he's making progress. As you know, 2 weeks ago, the president felt it was important that he should go to the Middle East in order to step up our negotiations in solving the Lebanese problem, the withdrawal of all foreign troops from Lebanon, as a step towards progress on the broader issue of peace in the Middle East. He has been working up very assiduously in both Beirut and Jerusalem. I think he is making progress. It's hard to tell, and it's at a very delicate stage of the negotiations, so I couldn't say a lot more about it, except that I think his being there is very worthwhile, and it shows the determination of President Reagan and our country to work with all of the parties involved there in order to establish a lasting and enduring peace in the Middle East and to take this first step. And I might say that one of the things as a part of this effort is that Secretary Schultz, after his shuttling back between Beirut and Jerusalem. We'll be going on to Syria on Saturday to talk with the leaders there, so that we're dealing with all of the parties in an even-handed manner, trying to attain as rapidly as possible the withdrawal of all foreign forces from Lebanon and then moving on to broader issues.
Now, some of those who say that the Reagan plan is already dead say that it's because the president hasn't been determined enough in the past to get Israeli troops out of southern Lebanon or to stop the settlements on the West Bank growing.
Well, I can't think of anything that is farther from the truth. From the very first time that Israeli troops went into Lebanon, we have used all of our efforts to try to have that situation ended and to have the Israeli and all other foreign troops withdrawn. We are absolutely committed and have been committed and have been working as we in every way that we can in a very complex and sensitive situation with countries that have real internal and external concerns about their own sovereignty, their own security. We have been working and we will continue to work until that peace is achieved.
Labour's deputy leader, Mr. Dennis Healey.
That the size of the deficit he's likely to be running, not so much this year as in the following years, will push up American interest rates by the end of this year and choke off recovery. So unless he makes big cuts in spending, and military spending is the only area open to him, you're likely to see the recovery peter out by about the end of the year.
I know that there's a great deal of speculation. That's why we say that we are cautiously optimistic. But I think the signs in our country, and from what I've heard the short time I've been here, the signs in your country point to a good pattern of recovery, which we're very hopeful will be enduring. The basis for continuing that is to, in both countries, to maintain confidence, the confidence of people who are making financial decisions, the fact that government policies will be stable, monetary policies will be stable, fiscal policies will be stable and appropriate. These are the kinds of things that will make the economic recovery continue and be a long-lasting, inflation-free recovery.
But there is a fear that the American recovery, for one, could be snuffed out if interest rates go up again in your country. And is it not feasible that the president's policy has to include a rising in interest rates simply because he's got to borrow so much money?
No, we don't feel that that interest rates should rise. As a matter of fact, we're doing everything that they so that they will not. The president presented to the Congress a budget strategy which involves declining deficit rates from now to the end of the decade, at which time we will have the budget in balance if these strategies are followed. It involves decreasing our own federal spending on certain programs and certainly cutting the increase in those programs. It involves a standby tax if necessary, if the combination of spending cuts and recovery, growth in the economy are not sufficient, so that we have a guaranteed method if it will be adopted by the Congress in order to provide for decreasing deficits. But we feel that there is adequate funding available for the investment that will be necessary for economic growth as well as to maintain a declining deficit pattern in our country. Well, Donald Reagan, our Secretary of the Treasury, had an interesting article in today's Herald Tribune in which he says this locomotive theory of the United States pulling the rest of the world out is a theory of bygone eras. He said it's now more like a team of horses pulling together, and I think that's the feeling in our country and the feeling that which will be projected to the Williamsburg summit later this month.
Well, now, at the Williamsburg Economic Summit, I mean, isn't it just going to be a political junket? I mean, what of any substance do you expect to come from it?
Well, first of all, I think there's a real value, as has been demonstrated in the last 2 years, of the leaders of the industrialized world, the industrialized free world, getting together and maintaining not only a discussion of the key problems, but also developing a personal relationship. Because in between summits, there are bound to be problems that come up, differences between our countries. And the ability of people who know each other personally, who get along well together personally, be able to discuss those in the interim is a very important aspect of our relationships. But beyond that, I think the fact of recovery, the ability to harmonize our economies and discuss how that might be done, the fact that each country has to handle its own economy in its own way, but by communicating between countries we have a better chance of having harmony among our economies, I think all of these things are very important and will be a substantive result of Williamsburg, not in terms of some major agreements, because that's not the purpose, but in terms of the relationship between the leaders and ultimately the relationship between our countries.
So you follow a policy of each country finding its own salvation. You wouldn't even go as far as to say they ought to have some agreement about exchange rates.
I don't think you can. I think each country has to do what they can in order to rebuild their own economies and to have the best economic progress that they can, and it's on that basis that exchange rate problems will be solved. I think it's also important, obviously, that the countries do agree on a maximum of free trade and fair trade to discourage in every way possible protectionism and the kinds of things that inhibit trade and economic recovery. I think this is the best way to get at the ultimate problems of exchange rates as well as other symptoms of economic difficulty.
But now, that is, with respect, easily said, and politicians go on saying it. Are you not going to disappoint expectations that the world can really keep this recovery going?
I don't think we'll disappoint expectations. I think that out of the summit...
Why, because they're a nil?
Well, I think that you don't want to have overly exaggerated expectations, certainly of the summit. The summit by itself is not going to do it. But the actions taken at the summit, the discussions at the summit, will lead to the economic actions, I think, in the individual countries, which will contribute to the recovery. The unemployment problem in our country, it's both cyclical due to the recession and also structural due to some basic changes in our heavy industry. But this is going to be solved by economic growth, by the kinds of programs the president has advocated in terms of job training and job retraining, the assistance to dislocated workers, those kinds of things. That's the way we have to solve our problem. You have specific ways in which it will be solved in the United Kingdom. Together, we will be working and communicating as to how jointly, in our various ways, we can promote in the Western world an economic recovery that will take in the entire area.
Do you expect Mrs. Thatcher to turn up there even if she calls a general election?
Well, that's something you would know better than I would. But from what I understand in my meetings with her yesterday, I'm pretty well convinced she'll be at Williamsburg.
I mean, you wouldn't be amused if a government were returned in this country which said, stop cruise missiles, end United States nuclear bases.
Well, again, this is a matter for decision here in the United Kingdom, and it would be inappropriate for me to comment. But I must say that over the years, we have always had confidence in the democratic process of your government and that the result of those processes would be a government that would be compatible, because I think our basic interests in both of our countries are the same.
But the Labour Party's policy would blow quite a large hole in your present plans.
Well, I think it's better not to discuss those hypothetical questions.
Is President Reagan going to try for a second term?
Well, he said that he'll make up his mind at the right time, and the right time, I suspect, will be late summer or early fall. But I think from a personal standpoint, if I were to speculate, unless there's some major change, which I don't foresee either generally or in his personal situation, I would anticipate that he probably will run again. As a matter of fact, I think that if he had to make the decision today, he definitely would decide to run.
So what might stop him? Would it be his health?
I don't see any problem there at all. As a matter of fact, he is healthier today because of exercising and other things than he was even before his election. I think he's in very good shape. The job, a difficult job, has not taken an undue toll on him. He is vigorous and energetic, and I think thoroughly enjoying the fact that he is making progress toward the objectives on which he ran.